Moving on to the next talk on transplants from donors with resolved or active SARS-CoV-2 infection. Is it safe? A contemporary review. May I invite the speaker, Dr. Anil K. Balla. I'd like to invite the chairpersons for this session, Dr. Alexis Garnett and Dr. Rajan Ravichandran. Over to the chairpersons.
I have the pleasant job of introducing my good friend, Anil Balla. I know him for several years. He's a very senior and a well-known nephrologist. He's the director and head of Sri Gangaram Hospital Nephrology Department and has a very wide experience. He has several awards and several publications to his credit. And I'm sure we are all very eager to hear Dr. Balla speak on the donors aspect that relates to the COVID infection. Dr. Balla.
Thank you, Dr. Rajan Ravichandran. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers, especially Dr. Vivek Kutte, for giving me the opportunity to speak on this very important topic, which is very close to heart to Dr. Vivek Kutte. Dr. Vivek Kutte, maybe in the world, he has done the maximum work, published work in the last 1.5 years. And the whole credit goes to Dr. Vivek Kutte for bringing this at the world map. Now, already extensive review has been done as far as the recipient with COVID infection is concerned. I will be discussing about the how safe is the organs from SARS-CoV-2 infected donors. Now, when the pandemic occurred and the lockdown occurred in March 20, in fact, we at Gangaram Hospital did not stop our transplant program because the patients were coming from, most of the patients were from outside Delhi, being the tertiary care hospital, and there was already problems with the dialysis because most of the smaller dialysis centers had closed down in the city, and we had a lot of rush in the dialysis unit, and the these patients of kidney transplant along with their family and donor, they were regularly coming to the hospital which has been designated as a COVID hospital. So there was a risk to patient as well as the donor also. And that's what actually happened, that there was a clear-cut risk of donor getting catching the infection. So we have to see how to evaluate the donor in a pandemic era and how the donor selection was done and the candidacy for and timing of transplantation and the clinical management after transplantation. So what are the various issues which are important? One is that SARS-CoV virus appears rarely in the blood and it is seen 1 in 15% of patients with severe infection. And RNA has also been detected stool as well as urine. The virus particles and high levels of RNA have been isolated from lung tissue because it is the main area, main organ which is involved by through COVID is actually the lung tissue. Exponentially low levels of RNA have been detected in kidneys, liver, and heart tissues. The donor testing its utility and accuracy in the present of in the pandemic era, the highest rates of positive tests have been obtained from bronchoalveolar lavage specimens, almost to the tune of 95%, and sputum 72%, whereas oropharyngeal swabs vary from 30 to 70%. The sensitivity and specificity of the testing vary depending on the source as well as platform. The blood and bowel specimens have the highest likelihood of capturing a positive COVID-19 test in the donor. And the neutrogen antigen testing for blood, urine, stool, and antigen testing from respiratory samples is not recommended. Now, can this infection be transmitted through living or diseased donors? The precise risk is unclear. The risk is highest for lung transplant recipients. The viability of the virus within the blood and its viability within the specific organ compartments of an infected donor can vary. The risk of transplant candidates' mortality while on transplant waiting list, as well as the impact that a COVID-19 donor-derived infection could have on the recipient's medical system and community should be assessed first. A national survey was done by International Society of Nephrology with the aim to find out the practice patterns for accepting living kidney donors with prior COVID-19 infection. A 25-question survey was done, which included 174 participants, which included transplant infection disease specialists, surgeons, as well as nephrologists. And 115 U.S. transplant centers were included in this study. and 42 out of 98 approved to proceed with donation. The willingness to accept COVID-19 recovered and living donors was in 91% with waiting period of more than 1 month from the onset of infection, whereas 51% would wait for more than 3 months from the onset of infection to living donor surgery. The most common reasons to exclude was ATI in donor and COVID-related pneumonia in donor. And most common concerns were kidney health post-donation and risk of transmission to recipient. Now, the various published series on kidney transplant, the results of kidney transplant from donors with resolved active infection, the in donors, the time from diagnosis varied from 30 to 140 days, and infection was documented through nasopharyngeal swab. And in recipients, the infection, there were recipients also who had infection and which was cured. And minimum one month period was there. The draft outcome that as far as that these recovered the kidney donors recovered transplants, there was no difference except for one patient who had ATI. Majority of the patients did not have any complication. Now, this is by Vivek Putte et al., the visual abstract published in January 21. Which studied, which was a large study at that time. There was not published work much available in the literature. And this study was done at 19 centers with 31 kidney transplants. And mean age was 44 years of donor's age. And 100% were actually were managed at home. And 71% patients were asymptomatic. And 29% were having mild symptoms. And out of the recipients, 87% had comorbidities. And even we continued with 13 ABO incompatible transplant also during COVID era. And 13% were COVID ABO incompatible out of these patients. Outcome were excellent, and the 100% recipient survivor, draft survivor, and donor survivor, and 6.4% acute cellular rejection. So all donor and recipients were asymptomatic with normal creatinine at 44 days. And we, by that time, had done five transplants from recovered donors, and all five were doing well. Coming to heart transplantation, with standard immunosuppression protocols were followed, and all recipients remained asymptomatic and did not develop COVID infection. There was no infection transmission to the transplant team. All recipients were alive with well-functioning grafts. Now, similarly, in liver transplant also, all donor and recipients were discharged in stable condition. There was no COVID-19 related complications among the donor or recipients during the perioperative and follow-up period. The lung transplantation, there was definitely already highlighted by previous speaker. In fact, it was diseased donor transplants, and wherever there was active infection, in fact, although the RT-PCR report was negative, but the bronchoalveolar machines came positive at the time of surgery. And these patients, actually, there was prolonged intubation and draft failure. So, in fact, the conclusion was that lung transplant should be postponed as far as possible if there is a donor which are recovered with, because there is a clear-cut transmission through the organ as far as lung transplant is concerned. Now, this was the our ISOT consensus statement for kidney transplant recipient and donor with a previous diagnosis of COVID infection. In this, they recommended that both kidney transplant patient and the recipient and the donor with a previous diagnosis of COVID infection should be considered for transplantation after comprehensive pre-transplant evaluation, using a combination of clinical, radiological, and laboratory criteria with individualized risk-benefit analysis. Before transplantation, complete symptom resolution for at least 28 days, two negative RT-PCRs, and one just before the transplant should be negative, and normal CT chest imaging within 24 to 40, 72 hours prior to transplantation. Adequate pre-transplant screening with multidisciplinary team involving cardiopulmonary specialties. And after transplantation, standard drug and doses on dose of induction and maintenance immunosuppressive regimes to be continued, and donor and recipient pair to continue safety precautions. The donor recipient pair should sign a written informed consent explaining the risk benefit analysis. This was very important. A special consent had to be taken before proceeding for these transplants. However, it was mentioned as a disclaimer that this pandemic is evolving in a dynamic manner. Therefore, this consensus statement is a live and dynamic document and will require updating as per the evolving situation. This was the widely publicized guidelines by American Society of Transplantation, which clearly showed that negative RT-PCR testing from the respiratory tract, including lower respiratory tract testing in potential lung donors, donor is between 21 to 90 days from initial symptoms. So they mentioned a minimum waiting period of 21 days. While ISOT mentioned about 28 days, and most of the centers followed that at least 1 month symptom-free after negative report. And symptoms should be resolved, and infectious disease experts should be consulted. Further studies are needed to determine the long-term clinical impact of COVID-19 on organ function and whether accepting these allografts from infected donors will affect post-transplant outcomes. That time will tell. Even in cases with no damage to the transplanted organs, it has not yet been determined whether subclinical damage that may later on become clinically significant has occurred. And decision to reduce immunosuppression during the pandemic should consider the balance between the disease activity and the risk of rejection. As already highlighted by Dr. Ray, most of the centers, in practically all centers, did not make any change in the immunosuppressive protocols. This is a contemporary review of all the published literature about the safety of organs, about 25 reports from PubMed and Google Scholar database research. And the conclusion was that the recommendation is that donors may be considered after recovery from COVID-19, ideal to document two negative RT-PCRs, preferably LRT sample and symptom resolution. Donation from infected donors must be individualized and ensure vaccination of donor as well as recipients. So to conclude, risk of transmitting SARS-CoV infection from an organ donor to a recipient is theoretical and based upon the detection of viral RNA in organs that can be transplanted. For example, lung, heart, kidney, intestine, and other sites, that is blood and urine. Viable infectious virus can be cultured from lung and other parts of respiratory and GIT tract. Additional studies are required to find whether SARS-CoV infection detected at extra-respiratory site is intact, whether this virus is replication competent, or whether it is transmissible by non-lung transplantation. Lung transplantation, there is no doubt. Data from small series has shown that transplantation of non-respiratory organs from SARS-CoV infected donors can be successfully performed without evidence of donor-derived SARS-CoV infection. Bloodborne transmission has not been reported and is not expected. Post-transplant risk is higher than general population and may shed amounts of virus for much longer duration than the healthy host. RT-PCR is the main assay used for screening. Donor screening should be done by careful history, by chest imaging like HRCT and microbiological testing. And decision to proceed for transplantation should take into account the urgency of transplantation and risk and benefits in each individual. Deferral period is minimum of 28 days of symptom-free interval. And at least two RT-PCR should be negative. Vaccination of donor and recipient should be done as per recommendation. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks for patient hearing.
I request the chairpersons to take over. Dr. Rajan.
Okay. Thanks, Bala, for that excellent presentation. I have a small question for you. COVID, there is something like a COVID nephropathy now reported. So does it really scar the kidney? What will happen to the long-term follow-up of a donor? Does he have a higher chance of hypertension, proteinuria, or a reduction in renal function? Is there any data available on that? Or have you seen any waiting patients who dropped their kidney function or developed proteinuria, and as a result, you had to reject the donor?
Yes, sir. In fact, that is an excellent question, sirs. And we are sorry, I have not looked into this aspect of the donors on follow-up. And you are absolutely right. We should follow up these donors from this point of view. This actually, we have not done that. And I am not aware of any publication showing the donor having more proteinuria, microscopic hematuria, or hypertension, or graft dysfunction. Maybe that if Dr. Vivek Kutte, can you answer this question?
Yes, sir. We are doing the ongoing study of long-term follow-up of these donors who donated organ after COVID recovery. And as on today, there is no RBC or proteinuria or hypertension in these donors. And one of the limitations was that majority of the donors were having asymptomatic and mild COVID-19. Probably donors who recovered from severe COVID-19 and they donated, that cohort need to be followed up more rigorously.
Maybe Dr. Vivek, you can involve all of us and we can have this study also.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Our pleasure, sir.
I think it's very important.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can I ask?
Yes, Dr.
Yes, Dr.
Suppose a patient has a COVID normal patient has developed AKI, recovered. How many days you will wait before taking the kidney, or you will just not take him as donor? And Dr. Bala, please, or anybody else?
No, recovered donor. I mean, completely recovered donor after 1 month, he is eligible for donor nephrectomy.
And these are all patients who have not developed any renal.
Okay. If you mean a patient having renal involvement?
AKI.
Yes, definitely.
COVID infection.
Yes, yes.
First, will you take or will you wait for a longer period, say 5-6 months?
Yes. In fact, I don't think international survey, International Society of Nephrology survey, that's what in fact on the apprehensions were there. Any patient having ATI or any patient having pneumonia, in fact, the survey showed that they wanted to exclude those. But I don't remember in our published work that any patient had ATI and then we accepted the donor. I am not aware of that.
I think the paper which has been published, there was no renal.
Yes, yes. I am not aware of any.
Hematuria and AKI are not uncommon in a severe COVID patient. Can in future they be taken for transplant as a donor?
These are also futuristic questions. Actually, we don't know.
They will require a waiting period of more than 12 weeks.
But I think it's a very strongly recipient-based program that only you touch a donor who has recovered from an acute kidney injury.
Yes. Yes,
the normal
yes.
tendency would be to avoid a donor who has an acute kidney yes. injury for whatever reasons. It's a concern that he can get an acute kidney injury again easily, more easily.
And otherwise, now we are saying.
We know there is a chronic sequelae to an acute kidney injury nowadays.
Because now we all accept that ATI is not a recovery and it is going to percentage will lead on to CKD.
We are running short of time. May I request the chairpersons to wind up?
And I thank all of you for this wonderful session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, speakers and chairpersons.